TEDx Fuxing Park, let's take a picture. Raise your hands. Up, up, up. Come on. We're going to take a picture here. Let's wait a second. This is a system a bit slow. Wait there. Wave your hands. Wave your hands. Yeah. There you go. Okay, excellent. Very good. Let's do some exercises. You've been dancing a while ago. Now, put your hands like this. Join them. Let's go up. Up. I mean up. Okay, let's go down. Okay, up again. Okay, down. Okay. Well, let's evaluate how well you did. You did amazing. Well, or not, I don't know. Okay, that's good, that's good. Let's give yourself an applause. You did great. It would not be practical to see that way, would it? But in actuality, that is how we see. Our eyes perceive the light that bounces off of objects, goes through the lens of the eye, gets inverted, and then reflected on the back. Everything we see up is actually down. Everything we see down is actually up. What's going on? Are we living a lie? Is reality, in fact, a huge deception? It seems that everything we perceive as true is upside down, backwards. They've inverted. What's going on? This was always like that, except when we were children. Scientists believe that when we are born, the image we had in our minds of the world was the way we see it, upside down. But after other senses started sending conflicting information, the image in our minds of the world flipped. We've known the structure of the eye and about this inverted vision for centuries. But more recently, in the 1940s, researchers of the University of Innsbruck in Austria went a step further. Professor Iris Mann designed these goggles with assistant professor Kola. Anyone wearing these goggles would see upside down. They conducted an experiment. A participant would be wearing these goggles every time his eyes were open. In the beginning, the participant couldn't perceive the world. He received a cane in order to move better, but even receiving that cane was complicated. The first days, he couldn't even walk without bumping into obstacles. They performed this test, and he cannot prevent the stick from hitting him. But everything changed after 5 days. After 5 days, the participant would still perceive the world upside down, but something changed. He could totally adapt his perception and reflexes to the new way of seeing the world, even though it was upside down. But from the 6th day on, he could live his life normally. He could ride a bike with the goggles, he could paint, he would perceive the world the same way we do, with the goggles on, upright. And this condition lasted until the end of the experiments. In the end, the goggles were removed. And now the participant can see upright again. Or could he? He would see upside down without the goggles. The same thing we do when we're born. We see upside down, then we adapt. Can we really trust what we see? Our brain reacts to what we touch and corrects what we perceive, altering this upside-down vision into something that is more useful to us, into a bit more practical reality. That's how our brain deceives us every day, presenting us a reality that's definitely convenient, but it's not what our eyes really see. The brain, the last analog device in a digital world, is a result of thousands of years of evolution. One can argue that this reality inversion performed by the brain is actually an advantage. In the end, it will be very difficult if we will have to tilt our heads constantly in order to understand what's going on. Our brain is tricking us in order to help us. Our brain is amazing, and it's also going out of business. A report by the BBC states that by 2030, 800 million people's jobs will be replaced by robots and automation. What? It's true. Let's do something. Please look at the person on your right. Now please look at the person on your left. Either you or one of them is going to be jobless in a decade because of automation. The same report states that 1 out of 3 people in industrialized countries will be unemployed due to machines. It's not news that the development in technology and innovation are making huge progress in the creation of efficient robots, machines that don't eat and don't get tired. Is there a way to compete with automation? Is there anything a human brain can do better in order to provide a differentiator that can keep us competitive in a decade? In order to answer that question, let's take a look at some examples of artificial intelligence and automated systems. Let's travel back in time to last year, 2018. It's October 29th. Lion Air Flight 610 crashes into the Java Sea only 12 minutes after departing from Jakarta. At the time, it was an isolated incident. Let's go back in time closer. Last month, 2018, March 10th, Ethiopian Airlines Flight 302 crashed 6 minutes after taking off from Addis Ababa. Both planes were less than 4 months old, practically new. Now we know that the cause of the accident was an automated system called MCAS. MCAS is supposed to prevent Boeing 737 MAX airplanes from stalling. Stalling is the process in which the angle of attack is too wide and it doesn't generate lift. The plane goes down. In other words, a plane can fly like this as when it's taking off. It can also fly like this as when it's ascending, but it cannot fly like this. It goes down, even with full power engine. MCAS is supposed to detect that the planes are stalling and correct the angle of attack. To understand the accidents, the planes were flying well. MCAS detected that the planes were stalling, even though they weren't stalling, and corrected the angle of attack. The planes crashed. 346 people died. Let's talk about something less tragic. Let's go back in time to 2016. It's March 23rd. Microsoft released its most advanced artificial intelligence system until that date. It was based on a very successful Chinese chatbot called Xiaoyi. They called the new system Tay, thinking about you. Tay was a she. She even had her own Twitter account. But Tay only lived for 16 hours. She had to be shut down. Just hours after the release, Tay learned from the internet how to hate and made thousands of statements containing racial and sexual slurs. It was a sad ending for an advanced and expected artificial intelligence. These two examples, Tay and MCAS, expose the greatest weakness of artificial intelligence and automated systems. Can you see how we can outsmart automation so we can still have a job by 2030? This is the answer. These systems will not question. They will read statements from the internet and they will accept them as true, just like Tay. They will sense that the airplane is stalling and they will correct the angle of attack, just like MCAS. Of course, engineers will fix this. They will correct these failures. But it will be very difficult to teach an artificial intelligence to question sensor readings. In the end, their whole purpose is to do as they are told, to obey, to accept sensor readings as facts, to read and accept. That's it, right there. That's our greatest advantage. Our brain can question. Our brain can challenge. Our brain can second guess. Our brain can be a skeptic. Some people call this skill critical thinking. I call it the greatest differentiator, the main differentiator between humans and machines. Critical thinking is the objective analysis of evidence in order to reach a conclusion. We all believe to be critical thinkers sometimes, especially when we listen to someone who's saying something we don't agree with. We don't believe it. But that's only a part. That's easy. The greatest exercise of critical thinking is not only challenging what someone else says. It's challenging our own conceptions and beliefs. As human beings, we crave knowledge. As a civilization, we always wanted to learn more. We made progress little by little, and sometimes we took shortcuts. For instance, we wanted to understand the sun, but we couldn't. It was too complex, so the sun became a god. Then we calculated its orbit around the skies, and the sun was a god no longer. As individuals, we're also very similar. We tend to collect the low-hanging fruit regarding information, just like Tay did. We tend to assume that what we see is the way we perceive it, but we might be wrong, and we have the human capacity to challenge what we see. Is there a way to be better critical thinkers? Jack Ma, who is working because he works 6 days a week, 12 hours, he couldn't make it today, says that we should teach everything different from machines. So education is a key aspect. But a lot of us are already doing our own part. All of you here are at TEDx Fuxing Park today, not because you want to reinforce what you already know. You want to learn something new. You want to be challenged. That's critical thinking, to learn more and to challenge what we already know. That's the kind of passion that's going to keep us competitive in the next decade. It's great that you're here, listening to new ideas. But remember to challenge everything, even what you see, as it could be wrong. It could be upside down. Thank you.